we have the pleasure of listening to the story of Professor Humphrey Nwosu, who was a former chairman of NECON, the electoral body of Nigeria. Yeah, Prof, you started with open ballot. We had the A4, you modified it, and then the election was held, and the election became so controversial, and is still controversial. Let me ask you, when you assumed office, you told me that government said, look, you have to give it your best shot.
Yes.
Before the election, did anyone in government call you into a room and say, this is the way we want the result to go?
No. What happened? May 18, Shoniko, Ernest Shoniko, who had a transition to civil rule government, who took over day-to-day administration from Babangida, still alive. Professor Nwabueze, who was Secretary of Education, was there, late M.T. Imbu, Francis Oji, and host of them. I was invited to their council to explain to them the preparation I had made with my commission.
Was after Babangida had left office.
1990, before June 12th. Okay. June, because he was supervising day
okay.
to day.
Okay.
Yeah, but we said, you know, and then Shoniko is still alive. And I'm surprised none of them is talking. And everything is blamed on me. You know. So he invited me. Nwabueze is still there. Explain to us the arrangement you made that will make for successful, credible election. I went there. My director of legal services, Buhari Bello from Kebbi State, still alive. The secretary of the commission, Ahaji Ali Umar. My image maker, Tony Iredia, who later on MD, NTA, was there. We went, a powerful team with diagram. I engaged them for almost 1 hour, 30 minutes, explaining all the processes, the logistic preparation, especially how to take sensitive electoral materials to remotest areas in Nigeria, places like Adamawa Hill, Niger State, riverine area, creeks, you know. We formed what I called Interministerial Logistic Committee, because election is a civic duty at all level, national level, state level, local government level, with community leaders mixed up with religious, mixed up with inter-ethnic, credible people, even at world level.
Were they satisfied with?
Yeah, they were satisfied. All to mobilize transportation means to make sure that there was no failure of moving material.
To the government.
I explained, and the process of announcing the result incorporated in Decree 13 that allowed us to conduct June 12th election 1993. People have forgotten what we do is guided by law. Akpambo was then late the Attorney General of the Federation. In Decree 13, a section of it, there was a provision that once date and time have been set for general election in Nigeria, no court can stop us. But Ikpeme Court tried to stop us June 10. So I explained all this, that when result will be released, no one, not the president, not you, not the transitional council, in keeping with the decree, in keeping with the law, the process will start from the polling station to collation center, at ward, to local government, to state, to national headquarters. That we would mount a large board to make it transparent. There will be no government interference in the process, in keeping with the law. So, it happened. The results were being released. Didn't you know about the big signboard?
Yeah, I remember.
Yeah, the big signboard we were releasing, the results as they came in, and people were satisfied, Nigerians mounted all over the place. Abiola was leading with all this explanation. They gave me stand-up ovation that if you're able to implement this, you and your commissioner will be national heroes. And that's exactly what we did June 12th. So there was nothing wrong in the logistics of the election, voters register, nothing. Results were being released. Suddenly, there was interference by Abuja High Court. Chief Judge of Abuja, don't release further results again. That was June 15th. 1993.
But the decree does not allow that to happen?
No, the decree, that's having conducted election, and the court says don't do this. You have, because if we had obeyed Justice Ikpeme's decision on June 10, the opportunity for election would have been lost forever. Because all the national commissioners were in the field, all the sensitive electoral materials had gone out of permanent staff of NEC. So this one, it was most unexpected. It was an interference, and we wanted to evacuate it. In any case, I was summoned at the meeting, the highest meeting of the country, of the military regime, National Defense and Security Council. I was called. How do we know about the result through your signboard? I said, yeah, that's what, and we will announce, even if you don't write it in signboard, after collation, the chief returning officer will announce who had won without any person having pre-knowledge. And there were monitors, international monitors, mm-hmm. At the NEC headquarters. With this, and I was served by Abuja Commissioner of Police, don't release further result. Now, I had to summon my commission. Before then, you could recall, on June 10, exactly 9:30 in the night, something unexpected also happened. Justice Ikpeme, late, gave judgment in the night that NEC should not conduct the election before even the announcement of the result, because that's a courageous step my commission took, which people do not appreciate. Don't. At the time they did, the person who came to inform me was the director of legal services in NEC with his assistant around 10:40. And when they came in, I said, what? He said, we've been asked to not to conduct the election. I said, which court will do that? But you know, we already had earlier this thing. He said, but they've ignored it. I tried to reach the attorney general. I couldn't. Tried to reach the president. I couldn't. All my national commissioners were in the field. I had only director of legal services, he's still alive, the secretary of the commission, Alhaji Umar. Well, having failed to reach the president, I said, the first thing in the morning, I will meet the attorney general, because he is the chief law officer of the nation. What is happening? I went to him, first thing, before 8 o'clock. He said, your director of legal services had just left, that he had asked him to bring all the decrees on transition. He said, what is he bringing all this? We are talking about election tomorrow. He said, no, that, look here, there will be election. I said, how? This judgment has been given. He then told me, he, as an Igbo man, Akpambo, you, Humphrey, as Igbo man, heading neck. Umadi was lawyer for ABN. Nzeribe was the coordinator of ABN. Go home and relax. There will be election. I didn't take him seriously. And he's made a statement that changed the equation throughout the country. He said they would have meeting at 10 o'clock. That was June 11. And after the meeting, I would be asked to go ahead with the election. Something in me asked, would there be a meeting, highest ruling body in this country, with me, a chief electoral officer of Nigeria, not being invited? I wanted to ask the attorney general. I said, no, I wouldn't, but I will attend the meeting, uninvited. I knew, I suspected, because that he might be a party to those, because the military then was divided. Those who wanted the election and those who didn't want the election. Pro Abacha group, I'm saying it authoritatively because it's in my book. And the man who wrote the foreword in the book, Colonel Omar, said so too. I said, I will attend. Have you seen ordinary civilian attending the meeting of the highest ruling military body in any country?
Did you attend eventually?
I attended.
What happened at that meeting?
Good question, because that had to do with annulment and what happened with the election and the steps my commission took. Yes. When I went, because the chances was I wouldn't have been admitted, but I was lucky. The security thought that I was invited. Being chief electoral officer, they opened the gate, open. I got in. When I got in, the president, ADC, Bamale, he died of this thing, was among those who wanted the election. He informed the president that I was around. He said, Humphrey was around. Well, you know, he asked that I should come upstairs. He invited me to the meeting. That's why when I arrived, there was Shonika was there. All the military hierarchy. Nyako was deputy to Abacha. He's still the military governor of Adamawa. Let any of them controvert what I'm saying 21 years after. I'm telling you what happened authoritatively. I attended a meeting uninvited to save June 12th. When I got there, the president asked, why are you here? I said, I'm here because of the election tomorrow. He said about the court. I said, that court judgment cannot hold on my commission. He said, why? Akpambo didn't explain to him that provision of Decree 13 says that once date and time have been set for election,
no court
can stop. I reminded the president. He realized like this. Because the military people, it's the attorney general that should have explained to him. He said, why? What provision? I reminded him, Ajibola is still there. Former attorney general, when I was next chairman, is from Ogun State. You can verify this. I reminded the president that in 1991, before the governorship election of December 14, 1991, there were a spate of court injunctions. Don't do this, do this. The president called Ajibola and myself, find a solution to this spate of court injunction so that his transition to civil rule program will not be derailed. And court jurisdiction not ousted. We came up with this provision. Once date and time is set, you can't stop us. And this has been challenged and upheld by Federal Court of Appeal in Ibadan. I explained it. Akpambo had not arrived. When I was saying that the Secretary to Government, Mohammed, went to inform Akpambo, Akpambo had arrived, that Humphrey was upstairs. Get ready. He came upstairs. Babangida asked him, Humphrey, say all that you said about provision of the law. I repeated all that I've said. He said, Akpambo, what's your opinion? He said, I should obey the law. There should be no election. It's in my book. How many people have read it? Having defied the military distinct hierarchy, I'm not a military, I'm just a technical man appointed to supervise election. So don't come. I wasn't invited. I went, so and Baba Grugobuble, I will explain. When Akpambo said I should obey the law, no election, I came with the director of Legal Services, Bello. You can verify. He's in Abuja. Bello said, my learned senior, don't misdirect this august body. Are you saying that the Abuja High Court inferior court can overrule federal appeal court, that there was stalemate there. In any case, while this was going on, I saw a piece of paper being passed. Abacha had stood up. Some others, quote me, it's in this book. They will not dispute it. Postpone this election for 1 week. We are not Banana Republic. Somebody who was sitting around me showed me the paper. It was a release from information officer from American embassy that if that election was postponed, it would not be acceptable to America. They held on it, those who didn't want the election to go on. Postpone it, we are not Banana Republic. Postpone it for 1 week. My eyes and that of Babangida Jam, he asked me if this election is postponed for 1 week to satisfy the feelings of the members of the council, what will happen? I said, no. I said, sir, in any case, this release by a relatively junior officer from American embassy had nothing to do with your transition to civil rule program. You have articulated a program that should terminate with presidential election. The local government system is in place. They may not be perfect, it's working. The state governors are in place, state houses of assembly, national assembly held in place. You've told the War College you were leaving. You've told the whole world. I said so. He was looking at me. Somebody tried to put hand on my mouth. He said, leave him. This happened. Shonika was there. He's still alive. Everyone say, Humphrey, Humphrey. What any other courage could any person show? And when he looked, he said, would Nigerians respond? But if you want to postpone for 3 months, tell me what I will tell Nigerians. I said, those who will determine whether you are doing your work well will be Nigerians. Tell me, if you are postponing, I will tell Nigerians that government have postponed the election. It was tricky. That I'm ready. My people have gone into the field. I went as much. This is contained in the book, which people didn't read. When he looked at me, he said, okay, do you think that's where military regime, without considering or going to vote, as you know, people were just still. He said, go and hold world press conference in their headquarters. The people who will be there, Olu, who later on was Secretary for External, Minister of Foreign Affairs under Obasanjo, will be there. He should tell that American Director of Information, should give him 48 hours to leave Nigeria. Director of Center for Democratic Studies, Omoruyi, should tell monitors, you are free to monitor election everywhere. You, the chairman, tell Nigerians, come out and vote. That's why I praise Babangida for saving the situation there. Not to any, we have to save the situation. And all these people were there. We held, Olu is still alive. Omoruyi, unfortunately, is not. We held the press conference between 1 and 3, June 11, 1993. An election was held. It was free. It was credible. It was monitored.
So when the court said, stop releasing the results.
Yes.
What did you do?
Another thing I did, I called emergency meeting of National Electoral Commission. And they said, look here, we've conducted this election. And in fact, some were looking forward to national honors we were promised. We didn't know that national dishonor is around the corner. Why, well, you know, the government set up a committee. Why I met at the commission, I said, we will evacuate that,
the order.
We are working for a body. We are not in completely, they appointed us. We didn't appoint them. We will try to evacuate that order. But you know you cannot rely on Akpambo, who said we should obey. In any case, meanwhile, they set up Abacha committee. And listen carefully. In that committee, the present Minister of Defense, General Aliyu Muhammad, was in it. Nyako was in it. Akilu was in it. Attorney General was in it. My humble self, the Director of Legal Services, my secretary, and Prosideria, a national commissioner, who was my right-hand man. We went to Abacha's guest house. This is real stories in that book. And no one had disputed it. What else could one do? Government set a committee. They knew we have, should I say no? When we got to Abacha, Abacha set a subcommittee, which included Akilu, Attorney General, my humble self, I think Yagudu, Director of Legal Services. When we got there, I told them, before this thing happened, it was only Taraba resort that was being awaited. In fact, it has arrived. Taraba, the resident electoral commissioner was Professor Pius Sada. He had come. The result was almost ready by the time, 15, two days, 3 days. When we got, I told them, we have nothing to discuss. The law is clear. We should be allowed to conclude I, Humphrey, said that we should be allowed to conclude the process that had led to this, that a winner had emerged, Abiola. I said that. The results were complete. But if you want political settlement, the government, that is far beyond us. Government can call Abiola, who won, and Tofa, and discuss with them and Nigerians that we are out of it. They say, okay, you will report to the bigger committee. We return to Abacha's resident. He said, Humphrey, report. I opened my mouth to say, yes, a winner had emerged. We should be allowed to conclude the elections which have been conducted, well conducted, accepted even by NRC. Congratulated, please. He said, shut up! I was ordered by Abacha, this happened.
He said you should shut up?
Yes, that you are not a member of National Defense and Security Council. You were in the first instance asked not to conduct election. You will recall throughout Abacha's regime that throughout that 93 to 98, he called the election I conducted illegal. His Minister of Information, Ofonagoro, called it illegal. They never accepted it. What again will tell you that the military was divided? He told me, shut up. You are not a member. And we should proceed to Asorok, my group there, that they will decide the whole process there. And asked me that I should call my national commissioners to appear before Asorok meeting. I wanted to call David Mack, is the president of Senate. He was then Minister of Communication. He was there. Mm-hmm. He was there. And I'm mentioning them. If it's not true, he said, that's the era mobile telephone was going. Mm-hmm. He said, give me, I will call. Who is the name of your secretary?
Andrew. David Mack said you should give him.
Yes, he called them, and the minute those came, they knew all this story. Why is Humphrey being, and they're all enjoying democracy? Humphrey, people are still talking about controversy. Controversy is about the annulment, it's not about the election. So when we arrived there, the whole military hierarchy were there. They said, NEC, what is their final position on this matter? I asked the president permission that my commission should be given 2-3 minutes so that whatever will come up will be a decision of the commission, not my own personal opinion. So they said, go. We went in. I told my colleagues, this is not time for debate. Very unusual period. We are set up by law to perform a function in keeping with the law. We've done it. The body not known by that law, Abuja High Court, had intervened to say we should not release result. We should ask, we should challenge that and release. We've conducted the only thing that will make it legal and legitimate was for us to pronounce. And the way to do is to evacuate that judgment. They say, okay, you are saying it. Some people were shaking. You know, military regime. So when we came back, said, sir, this is the position of NEC. We would want to conclude the work we started. First, Ikpeme said, we've gone ahead. We would want to evacuate this ruling. It wasn't recognized by Decree 13. We were told, okay, Shonika was there. All these other people were there. Who said, who spoke, who added voice for Humphrey? Throughout. Colonel Omar did during that process. That's the time he resigned his commission. People don't seem to know or read. That's why he wrote the foreword. He said everything in that book was true. So he said, then we were told, you are on your own. Meaning Attorney General will not take our case to Federal Appeal Court. Bello is still there. Said I should not tell any person where he took all the results, all the case to Kaduna Federal Appeal Court. The chief judge was Okeh Achike. He took the case to his court. Okeh is one of these people who wants justice, though. In that, all the results were submitted showing Abiola as winner. As far back as June 20, all the results of June 12, where were the Nigerian journalists? Were it to be in America, investigative, they would have published. We submitted all the results. Abiola was represented in the court by Eke Ajayi. Tofa was represented. They knew. Lawyers work with papers. The court held first preliminary sitting and ordered Abuja High Court submit everything about this election. Never you touch it again. My court, Federal Appeal Court, we engage in accelerated hearing and judgment to enable this commission to conclude the result. On June 25th, we will sit. Some everything should be. On June 23, we were dissolved, sacked. What else could any normal person do? I have some press from segment of the country had always, some people don't read. The controversy was political. It wasn't anything technical relating to conduct of election. It wasn't relating to logistics of election. It has nothing to do with credibility, with acceptance, with peaceful conduct of election.
Within this period, yes. Did the head of state, Babangida, get in touch with you?
He did not. The process, all this drama happened in the open. It happened when I said, if you postpone it, it will be the worst rigged election in Nigerian history. But if you want to postpone it, tell me what I will tell Nigerians. Because the general constituency, as I told you earlier, those who will adjudge whether election is credible or not, will be Nigerian.
Let me ask you.
Yes.
What was your psychological situation when this was happening?
The only thing that's what I believe in the Almighty God, whether you worship Him, the creator of universe and everything, we relied on Him throughout the period. There was no person. Friend deserted. Relied on God. And of course, government too knew that I committed no crime. And all the talk that I was beaten by Akuluba is nonsense. I wasn't beaten.
You were not arrested.
I wasn't arrested, but I was in my residence. And they tried to protect me at that point in time because there were people, because they themselves
were divided. So anybody could have harmed you.
Yeah, any person could have harmed
me. Did you fear for your life?
Who will not fear? When especially I told you how Abacha told me, shut up. You, elsewhere, would you be saying what you are saying? You were allowed to be doing what you are doing. Babangida allowed you to do this.
He said so.
He said so. I put it in my book. And people don't read.
So, protective...
And they were coming out. There was adverse publicity, as if to say, there's something I should have done. You know, throughout Abacha's reign, from 93 to 98, every time, police, there will be a contingent of police here around me, whether I will announce, what will I announce, especially when the National Electoral Commission was sacked. No severance, nothing, no rehabilitation. Is it the reward? What was the offense? And that's when you call it controversial. It's not controversial. It's the politicians that make it's politics.
A lot of Nigerians were surprised didn't speak up immediately. That was why people accused you of maybe you had received some money from Babangida and all that.
With the country, the military divided if you read the foreword, Umar said Humphrey, a civilian, how can he? He's riding a tiger. Can finish him. That there is a limit. Remember, I was not supposed to attend
that meeting.
That's what Nigerians. Some TVs closed when I tagged them. Nadeko. I said, why did some of them run to the United States when Abacha pulled Ferret? When people were demonstrating, many ran away, but I was not given permission to attend. I attended. I was speaking directly to Babangida. Somebody would close my mouth. I was almost like somebody inspired. I emptied my mind. Do you know what? If you are doing anything and you believe in it, you are committed in it, you pray for it, you ask God to give you. Nigerians prayed for that election. Christians, Muslims. Let it be free and credible. And God gave them. It was the military, the division within the military, the politics within the military. There was nothing controversial. I challenge any person. Debate. What else I would have done that I didn't do? And I was running a commission. It wasn't one-man show. We were appointed. There is a limit to what appointed officer. You must also show respect. When we were sacked, the Okeachike court would have held on June 25th. Accelerated hearing. That means, yes, Abiola, result. This is the law. Abuja High Court is an intruder.
Prof,
yes.
I want to ask you
a
very personal question, because this is like a document of history. Were you offered any money by the government at that time?
Absolutely nothing. And I've not been offered or rehabilitated since I left office. 21 years, no one had. People get severance.
You never got any?
Nothing. No one.
Not to talk about the national honor.
For conducting, people still talk. There are so many people who had headed the commission from Oya to Dagogojak to Gobadia to Taya Akpata to Iwu, but people still talk of. Because we tried the commission, all the people in that commission, technical staff like Tony Reddy and Tony Edo, I had powerful research department. Remember, we nurtured the two political party structure that made that election possible. Starting from Ward, they were co-owners and co-founders, from Ward through local government state, and there's nothing like it today.
Prof, you know, I wish we had all the time. But let me ask you, what are your regrets?
I have no regret. Whatever will be done, it has already been destined. I thank God that I had opportunity to do what I did. I really thank God. And I enjoy all the legacy I left in the commission. There are people who retire. Sometimes they bring whiskey that I made neck pensionable. Without me, they wouldn't be enjoying this. There are people who try to reach me. There was somebody, a lady, outside lawyer, 2 days ago. He said, you may not know me, but you made this commission credible. We've never seen anything like that before. So you left houses, you built offices, you built the headquarters, you know. And this is even what of human reward, what of God's reward, even of health. Of 21 years, one is still able, and people like you, younger generation, passing the legacy. No, it gives me joy.
Let me ask you.
Yes.
Since in the last 21 years, did you ever meet Babangida one-on-one like this?
Yes, when the wife passed on.
And you went to see him?
Yes, yes.
What did he tell you?
He's still full of respect for me in the sense that, and he had said so in some papers. I read it in the Sun 3 years ago when people were talking about being a lucky or said, he said, people don't know this man, that this man will do what is right and will tell any person to his face, because I did say so June 11 in National Defense Security Council. So much though that I high military officer, you don't tell senior officers, and it is something that changed his mind. And he still remembers the legacy. I'm sure that the fact, if we had handed over democratically elected government to Abiola, Abiola would have come and gone. The system would have been institutionalized. The two-party structure would have gained firm root. But Abacha abolished all that. Or party offices.
How would you describe Babangida that you worked with? Did you think he was sincere in his effort to bring democracy?
Well, no one can read any person's mind totally. Not me. The only person to read completely, totally, somebody's mind is God, who created, who brought us into existence. But the aspect of him that relates to what he was appreciating, open ballot, he congratulated me. When I moved the neck from Lagos and provided quarters for my staff, he came 2 months and congratulated me and said, if other organizations do what you do, not everyone, federal government, give me money, you know. So, and he, when we introduced open ballot, when he saw that it's working, he congratulated me. When the modified open ballot, we used it in conducting National Assembly election, and of course, June 12, after National Assembly, he congratulated me. And then, of course, throughout all this period, there was no, when I come with options, because I go to his government, these are options, A, D, whichever, you know, which was the basis of my appointment. Research, you are a professor, you are a researcher, go into this. He gave us the opportunity to operate until June 12, when there was division among his colleagues. I would say, perhaps if he had ignored his colleagues and approved this thing, he himself would have been happier.
Today? But
today, I think so. Because I would think he was caught in between. Remember April 30 coup of 1990. It was said, I don't know detail, military is complex organization, that Abacha helped to save him. So you can see between
the
loyalty to a friend that had been loyal to the nation. But ask me, commitment to the nation is a higher level, because if he had allowed this election, in spite of opposition from his colleagues, he would have been the founder of modern Nigeria, because the two-party structure would have been functional. And all of us, would have benefited, and you wouldn't be talking about controversy.
You sit back in your house and you see elections go on in Nigeria. You see all the controversies, the storytelling, and what have you. Please, in very short sentences, what do you think we should do to have credible elections in this country?
It is unfortunate. We don't have any other country. This is the only country, and we have been trying nation building for the past 100 years. Others have even a shorter period. They're able to manage their internal conflicts, because these internal conflicts intrude, affect the work of whoever manages the electoral body. I'm sure my colleague who is presiding there will be having sleepless nights, because what happens to election will not depend only on the core staff of INEC. He has to use local staff, thousands of them, of dubious loyalty, especially in charged, tensed up political environment. Tensed up, because the two parties are, the way they are carrying their politicking, and the way people cross from one party to another as people changing clothes, not guided by particular ideology, it is not commendable. It is not like the two-party structure, one a little bit to the right and another a little bit to the left, and people from their heart, you decide in your village and they all coexist. You join the one a little bit to the right, coming from your heart, or the one a little bit to the left.
What can we do to make it better?
Well, he has to work extra hard. I had talked to him once. You know, when you're appointed, you take charge. I gave him almost 4 hours trying, because there's continuity. One thing that is lacking in this country is continuity in anything we do. When somebody comes in, after a while, he turns his back on it. But it's not so. In many advanced countries, you take up all the good things and even utilize the experiences in subtle way to improve. But many of our people don't want to. I try to do it. I utilize I left, you know, for a few months, did some consultation. You don't know everything. I called Ovia Whiskey a number of times. But I don't think that is a trend that is happening. I'm not accusing any.
I was going to ask you whether your successors, those that came after you, whether sometimes they call you on the phone. When
the only person that called me on phone is Gobadia, Dr. Gobadia. He was full of respect. And I responded.
But have you not thought about asking government for your severance and your entitlements?
There was, you know, one of these permanent secretaries that is up there, you know, who looked into my record and said we should apply. He's famous in the politics of the North. He retired as he was formerly secretary of INEC.
And you applied and nothing happened?
We applied. He said he would take it to government. Aliyu is dead now. We applied, nothing happened.
Okay, you know, when we started talking about June 12 and all that, I forgot to ask about family.
Yes.
Tell us a little about your family so we can end this conversation.
I thank the Almighty God for giving me a wonderful cooperative family, starting from my wife, who abandoned her PhD program. She was advanced to PhD candidates, was a lecturer, abandoned it, was following me everywhere, prayer. My children were all solidly behind me, And that was also a source of courage and strength and firmness from God, next from my family. I have a family of four children, and they are on their own. They have to keep me. You know, in Igbo, he said, train your children, and later on, if you train them well, they will. They don't joke with me. So when I say I'm trying, they say, come, we look at.
Even if your country abandoned you, they were not going to abandon
you. If your country abandoned, we can't abandon you. They really treat us well. You know, they look after us well, you know. And when I was a postgraduate student, they were born there, so they have access to that place by sheer luck, you know, and educated there. And some of them, they are working and they maintain from a different source.
When we started, I said, you're looking good. So how do you do this?
You see, when you are, what we are, come out of heart, mind, the intellectual aspect, and soul. When you don't harbor anything against any person and leave it the best you can do, continue to do good, even when those who are beneficiaries of your goodness turn their back on you, God will not turn his back on you. Two, you are children, and some other God-fearing people God may put across your way. Like the story, who is your neighbor? Good Samaritan. There are many good Samaritans God has planted across my life path. They see me maybe at the airport. Ah, June 12th. Go. Oh, what? So, there are such people, and I enjoy them. So it's more than the so-called severance.
I do believe that someday, while you're here with us, that you get your national honors and you get all your entitlements. Because, this is the opinion. I think you've done your bit.
The highest national honor is the one given by God. You are held because you may have the national honor.
I will have good health.
Because I enjoy my meal, I enjoy my sleep, I have nothing against any evil.
How would you be remembered? I mean, if you are going to write your own epitaph, how would you write it? What will it be?
What we are and what people should remember us for is the humble, distilled service we render to humanity. And still, you are doing it not looking for any special reward, because in the process, God will reward you. You will even have internal peace. And that peace that passeth all understanding will be part of it, which God gives, even in a situation of conflict. You know, so in the village, I still go back and part and parcel. Like when the transformer in my place since privatization, the Urumba North and South is in perpetual darkness. I have taken this up with the minister. I said, please, at least, what do we do to connect us with a station where light is more regular? Yeah. And they have approved and waiting for budget for it to be executed. So this happened within this period. That gives me joy. 2 years ago, some of the engineers that work for NEPA, one whom I helped many years ago, said, apply for transformer, which I did, and even put personal fund. So that transformer, 350 kVA, have been delivered. Oh, no. So you find things like that. It gives me joy. You know, when I help to make other people's life better than It is.
Okay, finally, what would be your message to, I mean, you're another statesman. I mean, today we face many challenges in the country. What would be your advice to Nigerians and the leaders of today?
I will plead to ordinary Nigerians who are victims of bad politics, of leadership, not to lose faith in the country. Ordinary Nigerians, they keep us, they plant the food, the beans, onions, and they are all struggling. You know, I still remember when I was a pupil in Enugu here in 1950, Alton Imoru was mayor of Enugu, a Fulani. I still remember 54, 55, Mbonu Ojike was mayor of Lagos. There was less ethnicity of where you come from. People should ask what you contribute. And the best people around me are not necessarily when I was in office. There are some Igbo, but the key people around me when I was chairman of National Electoral Commission, I mentioned Tony Iredia. I mentioned from Edo. I mentioned Buhari Bello. We talked about 4 days ago. He went to Federal Court of Appeal. He's still alive to collaborate my story. He comes, you know. So there are many good Nigerians. And bad politics may begin to change minds of many Nigerians. I would appeal, please keep faith. We have no other country. But for politicians, I will pray and plead, don't rub it too hard. Whatever advantage you may have over your opponent, don't rub it too hard. And what we are facing today, the conflict, the disruption, no one expected this. Even when it started, maybe it was used as local political instrument to achieve political power, it had gotten out of hand. And I will plead, it is a national tragedy, especially when you are talking about school girls, maybe 14, 15, future mothers of this nation, abducted. It is terrible. No nation, no part of the world will tolerate it. I wonder how people will regard us. So I'm pleading that people should, security is a general problem for all Nigerians. We should all cooperate with sitting government to make sure that we don't destroy this nation. Because as a political scientist, we know conflict. You cannot abolish conflict in society. No one has done. But conflicts should not be such to threaten the existence of the state as the one we are facing now is threatening. Suppose it happens, where would millions of Nigerians, would they drift to Ghana, they would say, close their door? To Chad, it is even worse. Cameroon, who will say, no, stay away with your problem. So let us fix our problem. And we will have, it takes time, national integration.
Okay.
Yes.
So we should not lose faith.
No.
In the country.
Yes.
Because it's the only country we have. And that's how we conclude our conversation with Professor Humphrey Nwosu. Well, he's played so many parts in the history of our country, but is remembered more for his part as chairman, a former chairman of NECON. Professor, thanks for your time.
All these stories with us.
I am Obiora Ilo. Thanks for watching. And from Abuja, Nigeria, let's do it again.